Hi, in this tutorial, I will give an overview of frequency response with Python. Before we start with the tutorial, I will introduce some of my Python resources. I have made different Python textbooks, including Python for Control Engineering, which this tutorial is a part of. You find these textbook and other resources at my webpage. In addition to Python for Control Engineering, I have made Python for Programming, Python for Science and Engineering, and Python for Software Development. You find these resources at my webpage. In this tutorial, I will give an overview of frequency response in general. I will provide lots of Python examples. I will use two different Python libraries. I will use the SciPy library, or more specific, the scipy.signal module of the SciPy library. In addition, I will use the Python control system library. I will provide lots of frequency response examples in Python, including filter design and stability analysis in control systems with lots of examples. It is recommended that you know the basics regarding transfer functions. If not, you may take a closer look at my tutorial, Transfer Functions with Python. So what is a frequency response? The frequency response of a system is a frequency-dependent function which expresses how a sinus signal of a given frequency of the system input is transferred through the system. And each frequency component is a sine signal having a certain amplitude and a certain frequency. And the frequency response is an important tool for analysis and design of signal filters and for analysis and design of control systems. The frequency response can be found by experiments or from the transfer function model of the system. The frequency response of a system is defined as the steady state response of the system to a sine signal, input signal, when the system is in steady state. And this signal differs only from the input signal in the amplitude or the gain, referred to as A, or the phase lag, or the phi. So here you see a dynamic system that is represented as a transfer function, and then you have a sine input signal which can be noted u of t equals to u multiplied by sine v t, where this is the frequency and this is the amplitude of the signal. And then the output signal will be like this, u of t equals to u multiplied with a multiplied by sine v t plus phi. So the only difference between the input signal and the output signal will be the gain and the phase lag. So here you see a practical example. We can use a house as an example. So then the temperature typically during a year will vary like a sine signal like this, with a given amplitude and a given frequency. So this is the outside temperature, and then the temperature inside the house will also be a sine signal. But the only difference between the outside temperature signal and the indoor temperature signal will be the amplitude of the signal and the phase lag. So this is a typical example of a frequency response where we have and outside temperature of the outside the house and the inside temperature inside the house, which typically will vary like a frequency like a sine signal through the year. So here in this plot we see the input and output sine signal for a given frequency omega. And the unit for this frequency is radians per seconds. So the input signal in red is U of t equals to U multiplied with sine V t or omega t. Then this will be this red sine curve, and then we will have the corresponding output signal Y of t equals to UA sine omega t plus phi. And then we, based on plotting both the input signal and the output signal for this given frequency in the same plot, we can easily find the gain, which is in this case Y multiply with U. So then we have the gain of this output signal, and the same for the phase lag is given by phi or minus omega delta t. So then we can easily find the delta t, which is the lag between those the input and output signal. So this is delta t, and then we know already the frequency omega, and then we can find the phase lag of this output signal. When dealing with the frequency response, we typically use a Bode diagram. So the Bode diagram gives a simple graphical overview of a frequency response for a given system. And the Bode diagram is a tool for analyzing the stability properties of the control system. And you can find the Bode diagram from experiments of the physical process or from the transfer function or the model of the system. So here you see an example of a Bode diagram. And the Bode diagram typically consists of two diagrams, the gain diagram and the phase diagram. So this Bode diagram gives a simple graphical overview of the frequency response for a given system. And as mentioned, it's a tool for analyzing the stability properties of the control system. I will come back to the stability, how we can analyze the stability properties of the control system later in this tutorial. With Python, you can easily create Bode diagrams from the transfer function model using this Bode function, which I will demonstrate. So here you see a real Bode diagram for a given example. In this case, the transfer function is a first order system with gain 3 and the time constant equals to 4. And typically this transfer function will give the following Bode diagram, where we have the magnitude plot on top, and then we have the phase plot in the bottom. So typically the U scale is in decibel for the magnitude plot, while the U scale is in degrees for this phase plot. And the frequency is given on this x-axis, and the unit is radians per seconds. And also you have to note that the x scale is logarithmic. So normally the unit for frequency is hertz, but in frequency response on Bode diagrams, we use omega, or which has the unit radians per seconds. So typically we need to have some formulas that convert between hertz and omega. We need to convert between radians and degrees, etc. So typically these are the, and we also need to convert between basic gain and the gain in decibel. So here we have some formulas that we will use throughout this tutorial. So here is the formula for converting from ordinary gain to the gain in decibel. Here we can convert from radians to degrees. So here we have the formulas for converting from radians to degrees and from degrees to radians. And here is the formula for converting between hertz and the frequency in radians per seconds. So let's start creating some Python examples. As mentioned earlier, I will use two different Python libraries in this tutorial. I will use the SciPy or more specific, the SciPy dot signal, which is a submodule of the SciPy library. This submodule has features for dealing with transfer functions and frequency response. This SciPy library is included with the Anaconda distribution, so if you have installed Python through the Anaconda distribution, you have already the SciPy library installed on your computer. In addition, I will use the Python control system library. This is an additional Python library, which is not part of the Anaconda distribution, so you need to install it manually using this pip command. This library has lots of more features regarding control system and transfer functions and frequency response, and it's very similar to the Python control system toolbox if you are familiar with MATLAB. Let's start by digging into the SciPy.signal module. As mentioned, this SciPy.signal contains lots of functions and features for creating transfer functions and some functions for creating frequency response and body diagrams. And as mentioned, you may have already this SciPy module or SciPy library installed through the Anaconda distribution. So here you see a basic example. Here we have a given transfer function. This is just an ordinary first order transfer function with a gain and a time constant. So here you see the code for this example. We need to import this SciPy.signal as signal module of the SciPy library. I will also plot the frequency response using the matplotlib library. And then we start by defining the transfer function. So we need to define the numerator and denumerator of the transfer function. And for that, we can use this array feature of the NumPy library. So you just define the numerator and the denumerator, and then we can use this transfer function in this SciPy library. And input to this one is just the numerator and denumerator. So now we have defined the transfer function, and then we can find the frequency response using the body function of this SciPy library. Then we can use the matplotlib in order to plot the magnitude plot and the phase plot using this semilog x function of this matplotlib. So in this tutorial, I will use the spider editor. The spider editor is part of this Anaconda distribution of Python. So here you see the example for creating this transfer function and plotting the frequency response. So here is the libraries I need to import. Here I define the transfer function using this transfer function of this SciPy library. Then I use this body function in order to find the frequencies and the magnitude and the phase of this signal. And then I can use this semilog x function in order to find first the magnitude plot. So here I find or plot the magnitude plot of the frequency response, and here I plot the phase plot of this frequency response. So let's just run this example, clicking on the run button. And here you see I get two different figures. The first figure is the magnitude plot, and the second figure is the phase plot. So this is a basic example how you can use the SciPy library in order to plot the frequency response for a given transfer function. Let's modify this example a little bit in order to make a more nicer frequency response plot. So I will just run this example, and then I will explain the code in more detail afterwards. So here you see in this example we plot both the magnitude plot and the phase plot in the same figure. So I'm using this subplot feature of this matplot library. And I also provided a nice text on the Y label, because this magnitude plot should have the unit in decibel on the y-axis, and the phase plot should have the units degrees on the x-axis. We should have the frequency in radians per seconds. I also added a title for the plot. So let's dig into the details. So I use the same libraries, and I define the transfer function in the same way, but in addition I have created an array of the frequencies I want to find the frequency response for. Then I use the same bold function in order to find the frequencies, the magnitude and the phase, but now I create a more advanced plot. I use the same semilog x function, but in addition I use this subplot function. So first I create a subplot for the magnitude plot, which is this code. In addition I add some grids, some x labels, y labels, title, etc. So this is the code for the magnitude plot, which is provided in this first subplot. So then I use subplot 2, 1, 1, meaning there should be two subplots, and this should be this first subplot. While for the phase plot, I use subplot 2, 1, meaning it should be two subplots, but this should be the second subplot. So this is the first subplot, and this is the second subplot, which gives this result. So then we have a subplot. The first is the magnitude frequency response, and then we have this phase frequency response. So this is how we can use this SciPy library in order to create a quite beautiful frequency response plot. And this plot is referred to as a Bode diagram. So in this example we created the frequency response, or the Bode diagram, for a first order transfer function. Here you see a second order transfer function given by this example. And here you see the final Bode diagram for this second order transfer function. The code is almost identical. The only difference is this the definition of the transfer function, where we define the numerator and the denumerator like this. But the rest of the code is identical. So let's just see this example also in our Spider editor. So we are back in the Spider editor. Let's just run this previous example, this first order system. As you see, the phase goes to minus 90 degrees. While when we run this second order system, you see that the phase goes to minus 180 degrees. And here the Bode diagram has been made in the same way, using this subplot. So the first subplot is the magnitude diagram, and the second subplot is the phase diagram. So now we have made a Bode diagram for a first order transfer function, and it gave a phase lag on minus 90 degrees, and then a second order transfer function gave a phase lag on minus 180 degrees. So basically, here you see an overview of the phase plot and for a given set of transfer function. For an integrator, which is denoted like this, then the phase lag goes to minus 90 degrees. For a first order system, the transfer function is denoted like this. The phase goes to minus 90 degrees as well. While for a second order system, as we saw in the last example, the phase goes to minus 180 degrees, because each part like this gives a minus 90 degrees. So we have minus 90 degrees here, and we have minus 90 degrees here. In total, minus 180 degrees. For derivatives, it goes to plus 90 degrees, and for what you call a zero part, like this, it also goes to plus 90 degrees. So basically, a given transfer function has, in the numerator, we have what you call zeros, so each part is one zero, and in the denominator, we have what you call the poles of the system. So for each zero, the phase goes to plus 90 degrees, and for each poles, the phase goes to minus 90 degrees. So here you see an example where you have one zero and one, two poles, and then the total transfer function, the total phase will go to minus 90 degrees because we have one zero and two poles. And this one goes to plus 90 degrees, this goes to minus 90, and this goes to minus 90 degrees. So these two in total will make the final phase lag makes it go to minus 90 degrees. And here you see this Python code for this example. It's almost identical. You just need to define the transfer function in a little bit more complicated way. So here I create this as a numerator 1 and this as numerator 2, and then I use the convol function, which is part of the NumPy library, in order to merge these two numerator. And the same for the denominator. I create denominator 1, which is this one, and then denominator 2 is this one, and then I use the convol function in order to merge these two into one denominator. And then I just create the transfer function in the same way as previously example, and define the frequencies, find the magnitude and phase using this Bode function, and then I plot the magnitude plot and the phase plot using these subplot features of the matplot library. Next, we will use the Python control systems library in order to create transfer functions and frequency response in Python. So the Python control systems library is a Python package that implements basic operation for analysis and design of control systems. If you are an existing MATLAB user, it is very similar to the MATLAB control system toolbox. So it provides much the same features and functionality as the MATLAB control system toolbox. So in the next examples, I will show some Python code where you can use this Python control system library. The Python control system library is not part of the Anaconda distribution, so you need to install it manually. It's quite easy, you can just use pip install control. And if you already have installed Python through the Anaconda distribution, you can open the Anaconda prompt. Just search for Anaconda prompt in the start menu of window. And then when you open Anaconda prompt, you just type pip install control, and this Python library will be installed on your computer. So here you see a basic example. This is the same transfer functions that we used in previous examples. And here is the Python code for using this control library. We just need to import control. In addition, I use the NumPy library. So defining the transfer function is in the same way. You need to define the numerator and the denominator using this NumPy array feature. Then you can use the TF, the transfer function, function of the control library. And the input is just the numerator and the denominator. And then the resulting here will be the transfer function. And then we can just use the Bode underscore plot function of the control library in order to plot the Bode diagram. So this, compared to the SciPy Bode function, this can be used to plot the Bode diagram directly. While in the case of the SciPy, we needed to use the matplotlib functions in order to plot the Bode diagram. But here you can just set by here by default, by having the transfer function as an input to the Bode underscore plot function, it will give the following Bode diagram. So let's go to our spider editor in order to implement this example. So now we are back in the spider editor. Here was the original example using the SciPy library, which gives the following result. We had to use this figure on the semilog x function in order to create a figure for the magnitude plot and the phase plot. And then we implemented some modification in order to make the plot like this, where we have the magnitude plot and the phase plot in two separate subplots like this. And then this is the same code for using this control library. So it's this code a little bit advanced. While here we use the control library, and we only need to implement these lines of code. So let's just run this example, and as you see, we automatically get a Bode diagram that uses this subplot feature of the NumPy, of the matplot library. But we don't need to implement it. We just use the Bode underscore plot function, and then we get this result automatically. So by using this control library, we don't need to make so many lines of code in order to get the same result. So this is the frequency response for our first order transfer function. So this is a more complicated example where we instead of using this we use the same Bode underscore plot function, but here we set plot equals to false, and then the output of this function will be the magnitude and the phase in radians. So then we first need to convert the magnitude to decibel, and we need to convert the degrees from radians to degrees. And then we can use this semilog x and the subplot functions of the matplotlib in order to plot the Bode magnitude plot and the Bode phase plot. So let's just run this example. And as you see, we get the same plot. But here we have made it from scratch. Instead of just using this line of code, we have set here plot equals to false. So this command will not plot the Bode diagram. It will just give us the magnitude and the phase for the frequency response. And then we use the formulas for converting to decibel and to degrees. In addition, we use the features in the matplot library in order to plot the Bode diagram. Finally, I will also show how you can plot the frequency response for a second order transfer function. So you just define the numerator and the denominator, and we just use the transfer function, which is part of the control library. And then you just use the Bode diagram function. You can the control library has both the Bode function and this Bode plot function, but it gives the same result. So then I can just click run here, and then we see the frequency response for this second order transfer function. As you see, the phase goes to minus 180 degrees. And based on these examples, it is easier to create the transfer function using this control library compared to this scipy.signal module of the scipy library. Next, I will give a short overview of filter design and frequency response when it comes to filter design, and how we can use Python in order to plot the frequency response for different types of filters. So here you see we'll start with a low pass filter. That's the most used filter function. And here you see the transfer function for a low pass filter. It's basically a first order transfer function where TF is the filter time constant. So why would we use a low pass filter? In measurement systems and control systems, we typically need to deal with noise. And noise is something we typically don't want to have or include in our system. So low pass filters are used to remove noise from the measured signals. And typically noise is a high frequency signal. So a low pass filter makes sure that the low frequencies pass and removes the high frequencies, which is the noise. So a low pass filter makes the low frequencies pass through the filter, while the higher frequencies like noise will be removed from the signal. So here you see a typical frequency response of a low pass filter. This is an ideal low pass filter. So in the next example, we will plot the frequency response or the amplitude gain for this low pass filter. So the transfer function is given by this first order transfer function, where TF is equal to 1 above omega B, where omega B is the bandwidth or the cutoff frequency of the low pass filter. So in this case, from 0 to this omega V frequency, this is the bandwidth of the low pass filter, and all frequencies above this frequency will be removed or reduced by this low pass filter. So this low pass filter will typically remove all the high frequency noise signals from our signal. So here you see the Python code for this example. We have created a first order transfer function and the frequency for a first order transfer function earlier in this tutorial. So this is basically almost identical to the previous examples. So let's just implement this example in our Python editor. So now we are back in our Spider editor. Here is the code for the low pass filter and the implementation of the frequency response for this low pass filter. So it's, as mentioned, it's almost identical as the previous examples. Here we define the transfer function. So we define the bandwidth. In this case, I just set it to 10 radians per second. And then the field constant TF will be 1 above this omega B. Then we define the numerator and denominator of the transfer function. And then in this case, I have used the SciPy library. Then we just use this signal.transfer function and the numerator, denominator as an input to this function. Then I define some frequencies for this frequency response, and then I use the bold function, and then I use the matplotlib in order to plot the frequency response. So let's just run this example. And as you see, here is the frequency response or the magnitude plot of this low pass filter. So all frequencies above, in this case, we have set the bandwidth to 10. Which is here. So this is the bandwidth of this low pass filter in this case. So all frequencies above this frequency will be reduced, as you see from this frequency response. So here you see the final results for this low pass filter. As mentioned, in this example, we use the bandwidth equals to 10, which is here. And as you see, this gives a magnitude of in dB equals to minus 3 decibels. So the bandwidth omega B is also referred to as the minus 3 decibel bandwidth. So we refer to it as the bandwidth or the cutoff frequency, but also the minus 3 decibel bandwidth. So this is the low pass filter, but we have all other types of filters as well. We have, as shown now, the low pass filter, we have a high pass filter, we have a band pass filter, and we have a band stop filter. While the low pass filter, the frequencies above this cutoff frequency or the bandwidth frequency are reduced, in a high pass filter we have the opposite case. The frequencies below this I call it omega L in this case for low frequencies, below this frequency are reduced, while frequencies above this frequency are passing through the filter. While for a band pass filter, then we have two frequencies, low frequency and the high frequency. So frequencies below this omega L and frequencies above this omega high are reduced. While for a band stop filter, we have the opposite case. Then the frequencies between the low frequency and the high frequency will be reduced. So basically, we have four different main types of filters. We have low pass filter, which has this transfer function, and we have high pass filter, which has this transfer function. And then we have the band pass filter, which is a low pass filter and a high pass filter in series. So this filter, then we have this transfer function and this transfer function in series in order to create a band pass filter. And for band stop filter, we need to have a low pass filter and a high pass filter in parallel. So let's create these four filters in Python. So we are back in our spider editor. So in the first example, we have this low pass filter where frequencies above this cutoff frequency are reduced. And in the next example, we define the transfer function for the high pass filter, and the rest of the code is identical. So let's just run this example. And as you see here, the frequencies, I set the bandwidth also here to 10. So the frequencies below this frequency will be removed or reduced, while frequencies above the cutoff frequency will be passing through the system. So this is the high pass filter. Let's go to the next filter, the band pass filter. In this case, we define both the transfer function for the low pass filter and for the high pass filter. And then we just use the, in this case, I just use the control library, because this control library has a function for creating the series of two transfer functions. So this, I just use the control.series and the transfer function for the low pass filter in series with the transfer function for the high pass filter. And then the rest of the code is identical. So let's just run this example. So here you see the frequency response for this. Oh, sorry, it's not the low pass filter, so we just need to change the, this to band pass filter, which is a low pass filter and a high pass filter in series. So let's just run it once more. and then you have this frequency response. Where frequencies, in this case, we have the lower frequency set to 0.1 in this example, which is here, and the high frequency is set to 100 in this case, which is here. So frequencies below the lower frequency will be reduced, and frequencies above this higher frequency will be reduced, while the frequencies in between will pass through the filter without any reduction. So this is a bandpass filter. And then finally we have this band stop filter, which is the low pass filter transfer function and the high pass filter transfer function connected in parallel. So you just use the parallel function of this control library. And the input is the transfer function for the low pass filter and the transfer function for the high pass filter. And then we plot the frequency response for this new band stop transfer function. So let's just run this example. And here you see we got this opposite result of this band pass filter. So here we have the high frequency on 10 and the low frequency on 0.1. And then all the frequencies in between here will be reduced by this band stop filter, while frequencies below the lower frequency and frequencies above the higher frequency will pass through this band stop filter. In the final part of this tutorial, I will give an overview of frequency response stability analysis of control systems. So here you see a typical control system, where we have a given process. We have a sensor that measures the output of this process. We have a low pass filter, and we have a controller. In this case, I will use a PI controller. So each of these blocks can be described as a transfer function. So here we see the transfer function for this process. This is just a basic example. So the process here is given by a ordinary first order transfer function. Then we have the sensor, which is also given by a ordinary first order transfer function. And then we have the transfer function for the low pass filter. And here we have the transfer function for the PI controller. Then in frequency response stability analysis, we need to use what we call the loop transfer function. That's just all the transfer functions in this loop multiplied. So we have what we call the loop transfer function for this system. I like to call it L of S, which is the transfer function for this loop transfer function, which is just the transfer function for the controller multiplied with transfer function for the process, multiplied with the transfer function for the sensor, and multiplied with the transfer function for this filter. So basically, a dynamic system has one of the following stability properties. It could be asymptotically stable system, it could be a marginally stable system, and it could be an unstable system. And then we have the gain margin, also shortened delta K, and we have the phase margin, also shortened PM, or this phi symbol, this Greek symbol phi. Those are important design criteria for analysis of feedback control systems. So the gain margin, or delta K, is how much the loop gain, this loop transfer function, which is the foundation for this stability analysis. So the gain margin, or delta K, is how much the loop gain can increase before the system becomes unstable. Because in a control system, we want the system to be stable. And the phase margin, or PM, or this phi symbol, is how much the phase lag function of the loop can be reduced before the loop becomes unstable. So both the gain margin and the phase margin are important design criteria when it comes to analysis of feedback control systems. So we are back in the spider editor, and here you see the Python code for this example. We are going to find the stability properties of this control system. So we start by, in this case, I will use this control library. So we start by creating the transfer function for the process. Here I create the transfer function for the PI controller. Here I create the transfer function for the measurement transfer function. And here I create the transfer function for the low pass filter. In all cases, we just need to define a numerator and a denominator, and then use the TF function in order to create the transfer function. Then we define the loop transfer function, which is just all these transfer functions multiplied, and then for that we can use this control.series function, and the input then will be these four transfer functions. And then we have defined this loop transfer function as L. And then we can use this Bode function of the control library in order to plot the Bode diagram for this system. We can also use another function in the control library, namely the margin function, in order to find these the gain margin and the phase margin of this system. So let's just run this example. And this gives the following plot. So this is the control.bode function that generates this plot, where we set decibel equals to true and degrees equals to true. So here we have units in decibel for the magnitude part, and we have degrees as units in the phase plot. And also we set margins equals to true, so we can see the gain margin and the phase margin inside the plot. So here we have the gain margin, which is calculated to be 11.06 decibel in this case. And here we have the phase margin, which is calculated to be about 30 degrees in this case. And also we have calculated what we call the critical gain. The critical gain is how much we can increase the gain of the control system before the system becomes unstable. So in this case, the critical gain is set to 1.43. So here you see the results for the frequency response analysis for this specific system. So we have the gain margin found to be about 11 decibels, which is found here from the magnitude plot. And then here we have the phase margin found to be about 30 degrees. The gain margin can be found on the plot where we have this so-called V180 frequency. This means when the phase plot is going below 180 degrees, we have the V180 frequency. And then we can draw a straight line up to the magnitude plot, and then the gain margin will then be where we have 0 decibel here and down to this curve. So here we can read about 11 decibel from 0 to 11 decibel. So that's the gain margin. Then here we have the phase margin. The phase margin can be found where this magnitude plot goes below 0 degrees, and then we just draw a straight line down to the phase plot, and then the phase margin will be the phase between minus 180 and the curve, which is found to be approximately 30 degrees in this case. And based on that, and for those given values of the PI controller, we have KP in this example set to 0.4, and ti, the integral time, set to 2 seconds. And based on that, we have found the gain margin to be 11, or in so that's in decibel, but without decimal, it's set to be 3.57. And then we have Kp in this case equals to 0.4. Then you can find the critical gain. Just multiply Kp in this case with the gain margin, and then we get this critical gain in this case to be 1.3. So we are back in our spider editor, and here is the code. So we used in this case Kp equals to 0.4. So let's change it to the critical gain, which in this case was 1.43. And then let's just run the simulations once more. And here you see the frequency response, where we have used the critical gain of this system equals to Kp equals to 1.43. And as you see here, we have a gain margin on 0 decibel and a phase margin equals to 0 degrees. This means in this case we have what we call a marginally stable system. And finally, if we set a value higher than the critical gain, let's just set it to 2 or something and run the simulations. Then you see here we will have the gain margin to be minus and the phase margin to be minus. And also we have that this VC becomes higher than this V or omega 180 frequency. So this means that we got an unstable system by increasing this gain of this PI controller. So let's summarize this frequency response analysis of this control system. So we have what you call an asymptotically stable system when Kp, and in this case the controller gain, are less than the critical gain. And then we have that these frequencies, this what you call this crossover frequencies, we have this omega c is less than this omega 180. And if we have a marginally stable system, this means that Kp equals to the critical gain Kc, then we have that these frequencies omega c is equal to the omega 180. While finally, if we have an unstable system and this this gain of the of this control loop, in this case defined by the gain of the PI controller Kp, is higher than the critical gain, then we will have an unstable system. This means that omega c is larger than omega 180. So we have these three cases when it comes to the stability of a control system in the frequency domain. And all this can be found from the frequency response of this control system, where we have used this loop transfer function, this L. And then based on that, we can plot the frequency response of the control system. And we can find the gain margin, we can find the phase margin, we can find V or omega 180, and then we can find VC or omega C, which is where this curve, this gain or magnitude plot, is crossing 0 decibel, while this omega 180 is where this phase plot crosses minus 180 degrees. So the gain margin, the phase margin, and the crossover frequencies, omega C and omega 180, are important properties when it comes to the stability of the control system. And then we have the final results, where we have we can easily see from the frequency response if we have an asymptotically stable system, a marginally stable system, or an unstable system. So that's all. If you want to learn more about Python, take a closer look at some of my other Python resources. So that's all. So good luck with your Python programming. Thank you.